Good evening, one and all. We have about 21 participants right now in the meeting, and we are looking forward to having more joining us during the course of time. So we will wait for another 1 to 2 minutes. In the meantime, feel free to introduce yourselves in the chat box. Please mention which organization you're part of and where are you currently located. Thank you. Hi Apurva, hi Prasanna, hi Joel. Welcome to the masterclass. All right, so to honor the time of all of you who have joined us exactly at 4 o'clock, we will not delay this for you. We will kickstart, but we definitely look forward for the others to join us during the course. So once again, welcome. Welcome to this masterclass on understanding self-learning, the why, what, and how. This masterclass is organized by Trainer Tribe, online learning community for educators, an initiative of Quest Alliance. And it's great to see you all on a Friday evening at 4:02. So hashtag Trainer Tribe. So in case you want to write about this masterclass and your experiences about attending this masterclass and tell your peer groups, your network, please do not forget to use hashtag Trainer Tribe. That's our official hashtag for Trainer Tribe. As you're aware, the host has muted all of you. And the reason being that so that we have a very engaging conversation with each other and we do not get distracted by any background noise. But nevertheless, we have the chat box available. So feel free to make it as chatty as possible. Throw in your questions, your opinions, your thoughts, whenever you feel like, and we will definitely look through it during the course of the webinar. Yeah, so that's where you can find the chat section to leave your comments and questions. So just to give you a brief of Quest Alliance, I'm assuming that a couple of us have already attended the previous masterclasses, but for some of the new faces who are joining us for the first time, just to give you a brief of Quest Alliance. So Quest Alliance is a not-for-profit organization that works towards transforming school-to-work ecosystems through self-learning. And how does Quest Alliance do that? We equip young people with the essential 21st century skills by transforming learning ecosystems through educational technology, capacity building, and collaboration. So far, we have reached out to 4,000 educators across 50-plus organizations, working in having 330 training centers across the country, working with 45 partners in 22 states, and also currently in partnership with 7 state government partnerships. We would like to extend our gratitude and wholehearted thanks to our donors and funders for actually promoting and spreading the word around for this webinar and for getting all you folks here on a Friday evening. So without wasting much time, diving into the topic for today's masterclass, which is understanding self-learning, the why, what, and how. And the speaker we have today is a person who's working deeply into this framework. So I would let Jayashree to take over and introduce herself and take you on this self-learning journey. Over to you, Jayashree.
Thanks, Venon. Hi, everyone. Good evening. It feels great to meet you all, even if it is e-meeting. And it is wonderful that you're able to take time out and be curious and know about something that interests you. So my name is Jayashree. I work as Associate Director of Research at Quest Alliance. And in my role, what I do is investigate into research questions and try to build credibility towards all the work that we do at Quest Alliance and provide data and be able to observe different trends that are happening in the sector. And then try to also engage the different stakeholders in the ecosystem and engage in conversations where we are able to co-create as well as collaborate to making what is going to be the best for the people that we are working for. So I was part of leading this research on self-learning. Quest Alliance had been thinking about self-learning for the past 10 years, but it is since past 3 years we've been doing active research and trying to gather and assimilate different ideas that are around the world on what is self-learning and what is the what are the benefits of that and how do you go about enabling self-learners in this world is something that we are trying to understand. And here is our current understanding of what self-learning is. So it's great to see that all of us are educators and we are working with young people. So I'm going to structure this session in three parts, which is going to be the why, the what, and the how of self-learning. We're going to make this as interactive as possible. So please do use the chat box and I can see all your messages. So please keep them coming. So let's start with the why. And this why is particularly about why should we be worried about or think about self-learning. So before I go into the why of self-learning, let's all think about why are we here? Like, what are we doing and why are we doing what we are doing? So if you want to take just a quick minute and type your responses, you're all educators. I'm going to make that generalized comment. So why are you doing what you're doing? Can you quickly tell me? It is a tricky question, isn't it? Okay, let me rephrase it, right? Like, we all work with young people. Why are we interested in working with young people? Or whoever you are working with, why are you drawn to working in that profession? Did that help, Apoorva? Joel, there are some learning gaps and we want to fill those gaps. Good communication, transforming the life of a student that we are working as trainers, and absolutely technology. Absolutely, right? Like, so there is a larger thing that we are trying to do. There is technology. We understand that there are learning gaps. We understand that there's a larger purpose of contributing to the society. So my favorite educator is Dewey. So I'm going to give his quote here, right? Like, the purpose of education, as he puts it, is putting people on a path of growth, where there, it requires a process of continual reorganizing, right? Restructuring and transforming. So there is a change element that is involved in that. Yeah. Making them understand their potential. Exactly, right? Like, that's why we are here. That's why we want to do it. So as you're thinking about that, as you are actively reflecting on this, this why, what has drawn you towards the work that you're doing, I also want to present you with some facts, right? So imagine there is a transition that happens, and when we work with young people, we are basically working in two different systems, ecosystems. One is school, and which eventually leads someone to get into the world of work, right? That's the space that we are working with. And if we were to look at what is happening in the school system, these are some of the things that we're all very aware of, right? There are learning gaps. You know, someone mentioned it in the chat. We are unable to tackle the dropout rates, and the learning environments aren't very inspiring. There is inadequacy in our infrastructure. We are still battling that issue of having a school in every neighborhood. And there is definitely aspect of marginalization, where access to learning, access to resources is not something that comes equally for everybody. Right? We are living in that kind of a situation. And what is the implication of it? When there is a lack of education, it automatically reduces the prospects in the labor market, which then means the upward mobility becomes even harder. Right? That is the situation that we live in. And if you were to look into the work as a space, the jobs that existed 10 years ago don't exist anymore. Right? We have lots of reports that are coming out saying that the youth coming out of these colleges and ITS spaces are unemployable. But at the same time, we are looking at a massive demographic dividend, as we call it. Like, lots of young people who are going to be ready to enter the world of work are coming out every year. What that means is that we have to come up with skilling initiatives that is going to make them prepared to get into the world of work. But at the same time, some of our research is also like, and not just from Quest, some of the research also lets us know that there is not relevant job-ready skills are being taught in the skilling initiatives. And there is equally inadequacy in the number of jobs that are actually available for people to take. And adding to all this is another factor, which can be a great beneficiary, which is technology, which is helping you and I to connect right now. But it also comes with a disadvantage for people who are already not having access. So that is our real context. That is the context in which we are operating on. But still, we want to be able to help our learners, the young people, manifest their potential and do what is going to be the best for them, right? So what we are proposing is a change in the approach. Right? And that is based on two premises. One is that every human being has an innate curiosity to learn. And that is very evident why on a Friday evening you're all here, right? To learn about things. And we are in the business of preparing individuals with skills that are needed in times that are completely changing. And right now, what better time to talk about unprecedented changes, where we wouldn't have imagined offering webinars virtually to educators and connect with them this frequently in Trainer Tribe, but that's what we are living in. So how can you prepare individuals with the skills that can help them to do that, right? So at Quest, we are proposing self-learning as an approach to learning, which is applicable both in school and in workplaces, so that the young people are able to navigate the school to work transition more effectively. So I've said too much about, given you the context of why self-learning is critical. But let's also then focus on what is self-learning, right? Self-learning, both are commonly used words. We are using them together. Some of you might have heard it already. If you could just share what you think is self-learning, if you can just define in the chat box, and then we will talk about it. What is self-learning, according to you? Absolutely, Nirmala. Finding your own way of learning with the help of available resources, being able to engage with the environment and having access to knowledge and experience. How much we know ourselves. Real experience. Journey from unknown to known. These are great points, right? So I'm going to also present you with, there's a continuous process of upgrading ourselves. Absolutely, Soumya. Let's see. These are some statements for you. To look at, what do you think self-learning is a lonely activity? Are any of these statements true according to you? If you think these statements are true, please type true. Okay, relatively true. Okay, some of you still are on fence, I suppose. Geeta says no. All right. So Mythbusters, right? There are a lot of myths that surround self-learning. And because it is self and learning, we always think that it is something that you do just by yourself. And that it is only possible if you have high technology, you have internet and everything. And these are not true. Sorry for all of you who said true. Yeah, and I think it's okay to learn, right? So self-learning, and it is not true because a myth is something that is a false assumption. If you choose to make it a lonely activity, sure, it can still be that. But what we are really trying to say is that self-learning requires collaboration, because learning as a process happens when you interact with another person, or you are looking at a book, you're reading, but you're still discussing what you're learning to another person. So it is indeed a collaborative exercise, if you wish to keep it that way. And technology definitely is going to help accelerate that learning process. It acts as an enabler because it helps you connect with whoever that you want, who has access to technology as well, right? Like, or be in the internet. But it can also happen with basic phones. And of course, we are doing like conversations, we are sending messages to our learners through WhatsApp, through IVRs, through radios, right? Like broadcasting. In a learning journey, there is definitely a need for all of us to have some guidance and support. So it is not getting rid of a teacher or an educator. That is not self-learning. And not all of us always know that we want to learn this and we know what we want to learn and things like that. So arriving at what we want to learn can also be part of the self-learning journey. And self-learning is very individualistic as something that some people believe, but it can also be collective, where a group of us feel like, I think we need to now gear up to learn the skills where we can access technology, we can share the use of technology. So it can be driven from a collective self-direction as well. Now, I know these are like some big terms that we are looking at, but the next few slides are intended to break this down for you. Yeah. So at Quest, the way we define self-learning is that it is a process. So it is not something that, you do it once and then it's done. It's a process in which you're making informed choices, informed decisions about what you want to learn. So in some of our environments, it might be possible to say that right now I feel like learning how to speak in English. And maybe the educator who I'm working with has the flexibility to change that. So it is making that small decision about what is the need and then going ahead with that. It also is a combination of knowledge, skills, and attitude. So it is not just like having some technical understanding, right? Or it's not about being able to do something. It is also about an attitude that you have, an attitude which is deriving from your belief about what are some of the things that you truly believe in and things like that. So these three things, knowledge, skills, and attitude, allow you to choose what you want to learn. Why are you learning that? Where would you want to learn it and when you want to learn? As well as how will you go about learning that? So if we say that I am interested and fascinated by how to make my own clothes, then I can say that I have an event coming up. That's why I want to go and learn how to make my clothes. And where is, I know there is like an excellent seamstress right next to my house, and I can go to her and then learn from that. So making those choices, making those decisions about what I want to do and being able to access that resource also comes along with the self-learning as a process. And truly, what differentiates self-learning is that you as a learner determine when you have learned. So you set your goal saying that I need to be able to, I'm practicing fitness, let's say, right? Like I need to be able to walk 10 kilometers in like 3 months. Without losing my breath. So setting your goals, and when you reach that, then you know you've actually learned how to manage your body, how to manage your stamina, how to have right intake of liquids, and then you're able to do that, right? So it's all a combination of all of that. And what becomes, I think I have like a prompt for you, and I'll come to it in just a minute. In order for us to practice this, in order for us to do this, we have to believe certain things. And that's what we are going to be talking about right now, right? Like the values that are underlying self-learning. Can we take just, 30 seconds and then like say, what does values mean to you? Like, what are some of the values that you hold dear to yourself? If you can just type a value that you have. Integrity. Honesty. Cool. So these are, how do these values affect the way we do, right? Like empathy and value is something that never changes. Like, yeah, that truly like you really hold on to it, right? Like, so in order for us to be able to facilitate self-learning, we need to be aware of a few values as well. And these are something that emerged from the research that we have done is that one, deepening the connection with the self. Right, like, and if you think about what we just or how we just define self-learning, it is about knowing what I want to learn, or to say that why do I want to learn this, right? So it means that I understand, I know that this is something that I need to learn, or this is where I can go and access the resource, or these are the skills that I have, which means I also know that this is one skill that I don't have. That means like having that connection with yourself and checking in with you and knowing, and that is also a skill. How do I know what I need to learn is also a skill. And that can happen when you are able to deepen the connection with your own self, right? The second value is that it's the community and context specific learning. So when a lot of times, I'm not sure if this is true for you, but when I went to school, this is an example I give for everybody, right? Like I grew up in Chennai, And I think in early, you know, primary school, in very early in primary school, I was taught the concept of, you know, climatic changes. And I was talking, people were talking about seasons, and then people were talking about snow. And I'm like, I live in Chennai. I don't know what you're talking about, right? It is not connected to my learning at all. And it is not connected to my community or the context that I live in. So how do I make meaning of what is happening? So self-learning is possible when we believe that learning has to be community and context specific in order for the learner to be able to make meaning of it, right? Autonomy. A lot of times the learning process should allow us to be able to demonstrate something, right? Like we need to be able to make decisions on our own. We need to be able to say that I think this is what I need to learn. I think this is how I'm going to go and learn about it. I am not going to learn about a recipe sitting in my classroom in the desk and then like writing down what the recipe is, proportions and measures and everything. Right? Like I want to go to a kitchen and actually do cooking. And that's how I learn a recipe. Right? Like I make that decision, and that autonomy, being able to make that choice, having that freedom to make that choice, has to be a value. So you need to give a learner an autonomy to learning. And likewise, you know, co-creation and collaboration, we've used that so much now you know, it's become a yet another word that everybody throws around. But honestly, when you're working with somebody, like I have a 5-year-old kid, and when I work with her and then get things done, and when we do something together, both of us learn in that process, no matter how much we already know about something. And then excellence is going to be a very defining factor of self-learning, where, you know, it is not about competing always with another person or with a system or with like the larger society. Like that's not why we are learning. Like it is about like, I know this, now I want to do better than that. Now I'm like seeking excellence in this. I want to do better than what I was able to do. I was able to climb a mountain that is like 1,000 feet. Like, no, I'm going to be able to exercise so that I can climb a 2,000 feet mountain. And then making that as a true driving force that's coming from within in order to pursue some higher goals, right? Intergenerational wisdom. This is also a very dear concept, because if you look at your own families, wherever you are right now, we are not segregated by age, are we? So why do we segregate classrooms in age? So what are we missing out on that, right? How do we exchange some of the knowledge that the older people have had from their experience? How does that get passed on to like a younger generation? How can we enable that intergenerational wisdom? And that is very closely related to the community specific learning, right? Like how do we bring in the elders in the community into our classrooms to transfer some of the knowledge? And finally, right, it is about connecting the head, heart, and the hands. So it's one thing to know where we spend a lot of time, like how bright are you is dependent on how much do you know. But there is more to it, right? And that's where we will also like, it will come to a full circle. Like if there's also emotions that are involved in it. Do I feel interested? Do I feel like this is something I really want to do? Does learning this give me happiness, or does that make me really afraid? Because I just don't get the concepts and I don't have the time. I'm very scared. What's happening, right? And am I able to do the kitchen recipe that we just looked at, right? Like, am I able to do it, or it's still like an idea? I think I understand what a pan is, what a pot is, but I don't really know, right? Like, I wouldn't know until I actually touch it and feel it and do it. So these are some of the values. And if you will just juxtapose this with what we saw in the earlier slide about what is definition of self-learning, these are like directly like juxtaposed onto, if you have this, then you're able to draw answers for all those questions. I'm going to move to another one, and right after this I have an exercise for you. Please do post if you have any questions, if you have any thoughts, do post them on the chat box. It will be really nice to know, like, how are you able to relate to some of these things that we are talking about? If it is real for you, if it is not really relevant for you, we would like to know about that. So So the values are going to help us to like determine what I want to learn, why I want to learn, where I want to learn. We talked about that, right? But that's not going to be easy. And that's because of these influences. So let's look at, like, there are five that I'm going to talk about. And when I say influences, they can have positive impact, but they can also have negative impact. And we're going to look at both kinds of influences right now, right? One is about the power. You know, like when I was born, you know, like let's leave that out. Like I had to go to school. I finished like senior secondary school and then I passed out. But then there was already a predefined success route that somebody had determined for me, that if you did school, then you have to go to a college and then you have to do master's maybe, and then you have to get a job. And that is the only way to success. And that is enforced on me as an external power. I have to learn exactly the same algebra that like another class fourth kid is learning. And it doesn't matter if I have understood the basics of addition, subtraction, but it's just in the syllabus and I have to do this. So there is an external power that plays in determining what we are learning, how we are learning, where we are learning, and what we do with our learning as well, right? Like, and when do we, like, who tells us? Somebody else tells us if we have learned it or not. We do not have the access of tools to say that, oh, I think I've learned this. There is no way to like determine how we have learned things. There is authority, like, and that is the last point about assessment, has a very close link to the authority. Like somebody is carving out the route for you. They say that this is only acceptable. These are the things that can be acceptable and these are the things that are not acceptable. And this is the only way. You have to write 10-page essay in order to demonstrate your learning. And there is a lot of authority that comes in an individual making a choice of whether I can learn this way or not, right? There is also social conditioning. Like I think all of us are working in this space, so it is pretty easy for us to understand. But the social conditioning makes us think that, oh, if I am not talking in a certain age between a certain month of me born and between the other, you know, range, I probably have deficit. And if I am a girl, then I probably need to think more about, you know, getting settled, as opposed to being very career driven. Or if I'm a boy, I have to be career driven. And I may want to choose something that is very hardcore, like manly jobs or things like that. Yeah. So the social conditioning plays a very critical role. So there is, sometimes it gets very hard for us to even ask the question of why. Why should I be doing this? And why, if I have, yeah, maybe I didn't like science, because of my experience of learning. But why can't I then rediscover a love for science later and then come and pursue that? The authority doesn't allow me to do that kind of backtracking, right? Like we don't have any control over our learning process. The fourth thing is relationships. Has a very, very great emphasis on our learning process. So like I said, like maybe I had a teacher who I did not have a particular liking for. It could be for various reasons. We don't like our teachers. I don't know. I had like this one teacher when I was growing up in school. And then it's just the way she probably talked to me once. But that never let me like listen to her properly, because I always like, she did that to me, kind of attitude that I had. So then that avoided or inhibited me from learning. And it takes a long time and a lot of experiences to shift those mindsets. So we are not able to separate. It is the relationship with the person and not so much about the subject or the concept that I'm learning, right? Like, but at the same time, if we are able to use empathy, right? Like use empathy and compassion in our work. And as educators, I think that is something that has been the most needed from our end, in terms of like saying that, are we able to understand what kind of an environment this student is or a learner is coming from? And what does this mean? And if it was a bad day today in their homes, then how does that affect their learning? And so in that sense, like, and that applies to the educator as well. If we have had a bad day, then what does it mean for us to come into an education space, into a learning space and do our work? So the relationships play a very critical role in being able to demonstrate the characteristics of a self-learner or not. The fifth one, and this is going to be the one that like ties it all together, is the learning identity. And I'm going to spend just a couple of more minutes in talking about this, is that learning identity as a concept is provided by Kolbin Kolb. Some of you might know Kolb's cycle of learning. So the two people who've come up with it, they say that you need to have a certain confidence that you can learn. If you would ask me, like, I have this strong learning identity that I cannot do well in sports no matter what. Like, you can give me the best coach ever in the whole wide world and they may be ready to coach me, but I have this belief that I am very poor in sports. And that has shaped up over a period of time, right? Like, it didn't come on one day. It was like a sequence of experiences that lead you to having these mindsets. So learning identity becomes a core of being a self-learner, where you're able to think that I can learn something if I put my heart into it. If I have access to something, I will be able to learn. And demonstrating that confidence on an everyday basis. So you go over in four stages of developing this learning identity. And in the fourth stage, it's pretty much you're looking at every opportunity that is posed in front of you as a learning opportunity. So I am meeting this person on a bus ride to go somewhere. I'm having a like casual conversation, but I have this attitude of what can I learn from this person? And it is very closely tied to what we just looked at in terms of empathy and compassion, right? Like, anybody can be your teacher and anybody can be a learner. So it gives an opportunity for everybody to share our gifts to each other and then learn from one another. And what kind of a difference can that make, that attitude, that mindset towards succeeding in our lives is something for us to like reflect upon. And these are not inherently good or bad. I just want to clarify that. These are not inherently good or bad, but they have an influence. And that's why they're called an influence, that they can move the needle on one way or the other. It's just dependent on the environment and the situation that we are part of. And it is important as educators working in the space of self-learning to be aware of those influences and how it is playing in our lives and in our learners' lives and in the ecosystem that we are a part of. Right? So, cool. Right. So now I have spoken a lot and I could use a sip of water. Please do if you are also thirsty. Chennai is really hot even at this time. So this prompt is that I hope you have your pen or paper or whatever device you are like logging in through. Please take a minute and I want you to reflect on a time when you were super excited as a learner. Yeah, there must have been a moment where you were just absolutely thrilled and exhilarated that you were able to like crack that. And I learned this, like I just rocked it. Like there was that moment, right? Like one moment that is fresh in your mind as to you were so proud of yourself as what you accomplished. I want you to take a minute and then think about it. If you want, please do write, describe as much as you can. Or if you just want to note down that event, that is also fine. For some of you who would like to share with all of us, please do use the chat box and share so we would also know what you're thinking about. So let's take a minute to do that. As a learner or in the role of facilitator, you could choose either. If it is learner, then it'll be great. detached engagement. Joel, probably we should connect later to understand what that is. It's amazing that Joel says that it has been the most exciting learning experience. That's amazing, those words and those emotions that it has triggered. And it has taken you almost a year of practice and experimentation, which probably is why it was exciting that you were on it for that long and engaging in that. That's awesome. Thanks for sharing. Cool. So the reason I asked you to do that is we are going to move to the next one. And I understand that probably it's a lot of information and we are moving at a pace that's probably a little too fast. But because we promised the what, why, and how, I think I'm just going to go to the next one. How, right? That's what we are going to be talking about. And as you are reflecting and as you're jotting down your notes, you will see how the dots connect. What do you think is, I clicked on it, I'm trying to make the image not come. So I'm going to ask you a quick question. So how do you think we do this? How do you think we can manifest these values and manifest, a positive influence on self-learning? What do you think is needed? Anybody wants to take a shot and put in the chat box what you think we should do? Motivation. Awareness. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's a clue. Implement what we learned. Okay. Having more opportunities for that. Okay, belief. Interesting. Those are very interesting. Yes, imbibing individual values with learning identity. Self-awareness must be created. Absolutely. Cool. So there are no right or wrong answers. This is just a perspective that I want to bring. If you look at the picture, there is a clue there, but I'm going to wish you a happy World Environment Day because today is June 5th. Passion and love, of course, it is needed. Definitely. So the reason I'm putting that is environment, right? How are we enabling self-learning is through the learning environment. And that's what we are going to be looking at. Nice. Thanks, Nirmala. Thank you so much for keeping the chat alive. I am reading them. I may not be responding to them. So the self-learning environment is how we define how we can manifest the values and the influences and ensure that we are able to nurture a self-learner. Yeah. So there are going to be five things that I'm going to quickly run through. The first one is the physical and virtual learning spaces. So the learning as a space, the space that you are, if there are walls, if there is nature, wherever you are, right, at that space. Learning climate. Climate is more towards how are you feeling. Right now, I said outside is really hot, but I'm sitting right under a fan, so I'm feeling a little okay. I'm feeling like comfortable. I'm not sweating. I'm okay. So that is just physical climate. But a learning climate is how do you feel when you walk into a learning space? How are you feeling? We'll talk about what that is just in a bit. We are going to be thinking about learner engagement process, like how are we engaging the learner? What is the learning cycle looking like, right? And where is educator in all of this? Because we said that it is not removing an educator away, right? And we do need guidance. So then what role as an educator should we be aware of to play in facilitating this self-learning process? And then the most important factor is how can technology become an enabler and become so much more relevant in the times that we live in, right? Like to really deconstruct this idea of technology and then try to think about what the potential of that is in situations like this. Learning spaces, each of this can become a webinar by itself, which is why I have just plopped all the text in front in case you want to have a look at all of them. But essentially, in a learning space, the first, if you remember the first, very first few slides, under the school, I had said that the environment is not inspiring. There are uninspiring environments that our kids go schools to, or like study in different places, right? Like, and why is that? What can make an environment a lot more stimulating? That makes you curious, that makes you to ask those questions and to make the connections with the dots and things like that. Some suggestions, right, in the learning spaces can be, how can you make learning visible to the learner? How does a learner know that he or she is learning? And what kind of things can be like put up here to ensure that, yeah, I think I'm making a progress. There can be many ways of doing that, right? And having flexible spaces, and we are very used to having a table and a chair and we are all cramped in. We don't feel very comfortable physically, but we just sit there and it has an influence on your engagement levels, has, you know, constrains you physically and then it constrains you mentally. So having flexible spaces where if it is a lecture, then you have a space where you can come together and then listen and it's a one-way conversation. But then you also have spaces where you can break out and then do your own thing and then come back. So are the spaces conducive to that? So we may think about that. And how can we accommodate multiple learning styles, right? I am someone who learns very visually. I have to draw everything down or I have to make notes and I have to see things in order for my brain to capture it. And took me a lot of time to get there, right? Like I didn't get this when I was in school. So clearly, you could have imagined my childhood. So how are we like being tuned to what is the learning style? And how is the learning space allowing for that? So we have enough of visuals, we have text, but we also have things where we want to do something with our hands, right? Remember the connecting head, hands, and the heart? How are we accommodating that? And the fourth one, and I cannot emphasize enough, is making reflection an essential part of learning. So as you are reflecting on your experiences as a learner, right, you are excited. And then you started doing every day, right? Like you are like really thinking about it. And when you think back on that learning process, you're able to call out some of those critical learnings when you reflect. So how can we make reflection an essential part of learning? And is the space allowing us to do that? Is something that we may want to open our eyes towards. This is the first aspect of the learning environment, learning space, which is the physical or virtual also, like in this kind of a situation. How is this space allowing you to like see what you're learning? And then like having this chat box to make it interactive, what you're feeling, how are you feeling, what you're thinking, allowing for that and then reflecting. So be it virtual space or a physical space, trying to understand that. And the second thing about the learning environment is the climate that I talked about. Like I cannot be sweaty here if I were to do this with you, right? Like I cannot, I'll feel very uncomfortable. I can't be present. I cannot focus. And then other than that, what is important is the learning climate. There are four pillars and there could be many more, right? Like these are just something that we are floating as something that can be foundational. So first thing is that trust. The trust that I can come into this space and I can make mistakes and I can learn and I won't be judged. That my context, where I'm coming from, the kind of knowledge that I may have is also valued. And I can trust that that can happen. Dignity, which is also connected to the example I gave earlier, right? Like sometimes we say that, you know, we do a lot of discrimination of like, if you do these things, if you demonstrate these skills, then you're smart. If not, you're not that smart. And then we take away the dignity of a learning process, right? Like what really helps someone to keep their worth? What makes us not think of, oh, we are just useless or we just cannot learn, that comes from multiple experiences. How can we restore the dignity of a human being? Like I can learn, it's okay for me to make mistake, but I just have to be alert and I should. So converting that into something that like gives the power back to me, remember the power, so I can keep the power that I can take charge of my learning process. And the safety, we have a wonderful session on, if you go in the trainer tribe, you could find it. It's about how to create safe spaces, right? We talk about physical, intellectual, emotional safety of learners in a space. Am I feeling safe? Can I come into the space and not be judged? Can I come into the space and not feel like I might be hit? and can I come into the space where my thoughts and ideas don't look stupid or silly, right? And feeling safe that I can come and say what it is I have to say. And the fourth thing is accountability, right? Like I take responsibility for my learning and I am held accountable for what it is that I bring back. Like if I say that I'm going to learn this and this is what I'm going to show, then how am I being able to hold myself accountable to ensure that this learning climate is a conducive climate for me? So that is second one, learning climate. Absolutely, creating a safe zone is going to be very critical. The third one is about the learning process. We talked about how you know, how you navigate your learning process also has to be in line with, like, if you are going to just follow, like, you have to learn 9 to 10 math and then this time to this time, whatever else that we have to learn. There is a very schedule and it's not flexible, right? And it gets very hard. But even in those 1 hour, if that is a constraint that we are working with, how can we make that where we are allowing learners to make choices within that? Am I having the choice to set goals for myself that is relevant for my wherever I am right now, that this is a goal that makes sense to me? So I plan that this is what I want to do. And then I do. I look for how I can learn about things. I go find information. I look for triggers. And then I try to learn something. And then I reflect. What does this learning mean? How is it aligned to my goal? Where am I going with this? And then being able to apply it in a situation. So if it is a technical thing that you've learned, then how are you able to put it, apply it in a place that is relevant to you? And then share it, being able to be presenting and documenting our own learning process and then sharing it and doing it and having flexibility. And the reason this is cyclical is it's not a linear process. So you can plan, and while you're doing, you may also be reflecting. So you may go back to the plan and reset your goals and then come back. So there is possibility for you to move between these levels and then carve out something that works for you as an individual on your learning journey. Is something that we want to focus on. This is the third one, the learning process. The fourth one, which probably is the most relevant one, is us as an educator. Some of the skills that are very critical for us to be in the know of is how do we design that environment, right? Like how do we make this environment that is conducive for self-learning? And how much do we reflect on our practice? So I went with this lesson plan. What happened in the class? What does that tell me? Like writing this down. What aspect of it worked? What did not work? So what do I learn from it? And how can I tweak it? And having space to even do that. Some of us don't have that privilege. We don't have the time to prepare enough. So being mindful of that, how can we also integrate a little bit of reflective practice in our work so that then we can role model it for the learners that we are working with? And role modeling, not just reflective practice, but also self-learning. Like how much are we learning? How much are we curious? How much do we want to try and fail and then learn more and then move on with what it is that is manifesting of our potentials, right? And prioritizing learning, which means that learning happens. Like that's what is the priority. How do we learn? We can be a little flexible about it, right? Like that is, so getting our focus or what our target is clear so that we can be more flexible about how we reach that destination. And being technology savvy, and that is something that has come as like an evident need for us these days, is that how can we leverage technology, the things that we have access to, or repurpose something for fitting into our current needs, and how can we get creative about that? And how can we tell stories, right? Like what kind of stories do we want to say to make the learners connect the dots, to draw confidence and make it a learning, develop their learning identity as they go along? It's also something that we may want to think about. This is the fourth one, the educator. Technology, just a little bit talking about technology because it has so much relevance in this time and day, is that technology allows individuals to have flexibility in your pace. So when we think of educator delivering or disseminating knowledge, then the pace is controlled by me, like right now, right? Like I am controlling the pace in which the knowledge is transferred to you, for example. But also because this is technology enabled, you're going to have this recording available. So you can also go back and then like think a little further about what was happening and then gather your thoughts and then relook at it, maybe get fresh perspectives or even critique about something, right? So technology allows us to do that. So even if it is delivered at a certain time, you can come back and like deconstruct it in your own pace that works for you. It helps us to give wider access to resources. This is the only reason why you and I are probably sharing a common virtual space and then having the conversations. And our networks expand. And in this conversation that each of you are talking about, you are exchanging your information. And it allows us to document our learning in different ways. And it allows us to create visual. It allows us to create textual things. If you want to create something, we can create it, take a picture, and also put it up there. So documenting the learning becomes a lot more easier. And that is the fifth element of how we can enable self-learning. So this is all with the goal of creating autonomy in our learners, being able to imbibe that every opportunity can be a learning opportunity, that I can learn and I can actually overcome my fears and hurdles and then learn something and then reach towards success, right? That's where we are going with this. But it's not an easy thing. We have said so much that is about a learner and an educator, but these are individuals. But the challenges are beyond individuals. And we're just going to spend a few minutes talking about that. I may go over for 5 minutes. I hope that's all right with you. So ability does not determine access. So what we mean by that is that I might be able to make choices. I might be able to come up with, I want to learn this. This is whom I want to learn. This is how I want to learn. I can come up with all that. That's about ability, right? Like, but that doesn't mean I can actually put that to practice because of the influences that we looked at, because the power and the authority does not lie with me. It's away from me. It's outside of me. Then I can't do it, which means that a larger system is at play that we need to be mindful of. And self-learning needs time and space. So it's like almost building your muscle when you're exercising. It is not easy to make choices. So suddenly, sometimes we give choices to our learners. So what do you want to do today, right? Nobody might have asked me that question ever. So then I wouldn't know what to say, right? Like, how much do we know how to make our choices? So it may not happen all of a sudden. It's going to be a slower process. So we have to keep with it and then get our priorities right as to how we are building that muscle towards building agency and like making choices for ourselves or our collective. Choosing is a political act. And it is very related to, you know, what we also touched upon earlier, that like not everybody can choose. If I make a choice, it means that I am able to make a choice. Not a lot of us come with the privilege of making choices. And so it doesn't allow for, in that sense, it doesn't allow for everybody who has the ability to do that to actually like execute their choices. Systems need to pivot and transform, right? Like this, if it, that, all that has to happen, the systems have to change as to how we are, the systems that govern the learning process has to change as to what does learning mean and where does the power lie in acquiring the skills or knowledge or attitude. And that's something that as educators we are working with, those are some of the things that has to change. And if these things are not changing, no matter how much of interventions we do at an individual level, these are not going to add up at all, right? So what? Now we have learned about all of this, what, why, and how, and we are under lockdown because of the pandemic, and looks like this virus is going to stay with us for a bit. Huh? What do we want to take back from this? Right? One is that learning is not merely an intellectual exercise. So these are basically some things that I hope that you can walk away with today, as even if it is one of it, then that will be great. That learning is not merely an intellectual exercise. It involves heart, it involves hands. And it's important for us to get the perspective of it's all not like intellectual transfer of information. Learning never ends. You and I are learning every day. And we are like living examples of how we learn every day. So how do we facilitate that? And in these times, we might have learned how to do, I learned how to do the Zoom and present my screen, also keep in view what you're saying as a chat window. So the learning never stops. So how do we then create a learning identity, right? Like if I don't feel like I can learn new things. Maybe because I am old, so old, or I am coming from this kind of a community, I will never be able to do. So then this doesn't apply. So learning never ends. And that is important for us to remember. And as a learner, we should be able to adapt new strategies. And that is probably the most needed skill right now that we want to impart to our learners, as to how can you be agile? How can you learn fast and fail fast? And if we are wanting to support our learners and wanting to, enable self-learners, it automatically means we will be working with the systems that governs this learning process. And that's exactly what we said. The systems have to pivot in order for this to happen, the self-learning, this autonomy to come into being. We have to also work with the system in order to make that kind of a shift. And this is not just in the hands of a few people. It is a collaborative effort. All the different works we are doing has to come together and add up and fit almost into a jigsaw puzzle. The work that educators are doing, the work that the parents are doing for the well-being of their children, the community that is doing, as well as the policymakers. All of us at the end of the day have a larger intent of everybody should be good, right? But how are we working together in order to do this is where I think we are missing a few puzzles. So then how do we work together in order to make this happen is something that is important to think about. It would be really nice if you can ask all the questions that you may have, and I probably will have to hand this over to Lennon. But if I had a question for you, then it is to know what about your learning in this past 60 minutes would you be able to apply in your own space, whichever space that you're coming from? What would you be taking back and actually putting to practice? It's something that I am curious to learn from. Over to you, Lennon.
Thanks, Jayashree. So you can leave your questions on the chat box. We will try taking maximum questions, but due to paucity of time, the rest of the questions can be engaged on our Trainer Tribe Facebook page. But please shoot out your questions on the chat box.
You could also leave your comments if you don't have a question, that's all right.
Ananti.
Or it would be great if you could leave your responses to the question that is on the screen. So, Jayashree, one of the questions that's come up is, as self-learning is totally a trainee-oriented process, would you like to share a few tools in the current scenario that we are in?
So Apurva, I think, I'm not sure if I understand what you refer to as tools, but I feel like one simple example that I can give is giving some opportunities in our interactions where children are able to get in touch with themselves and then think about what it is that they would like to learn and be able to and these tools can be, I mean, I'm not going to give you like a major prescriptive tool or anything that is out there, but reflection, if you were to give them a journal that tracks their learning journey, I think that could be a great tool to use to keep a tab on what they have learned, because there could be many things that are happening. It's not like in a firm environment that we are working right now. So how do you keep track of and organize what you're learning and putting that into some visual, visually representing all the learnings? I think that will be a great thing to do. I'm going to take the questions and answer. How can we assess the progress of an individual when we conduct virtual classes? So That is going to be, Nirmala, I think that is going to be a very tricky question. I would just try to draw your attention to, you know, in line with the concept that we just talked about, right? Like in self-learning, one of the key defining factors is where an individual is able to say that, yes, I have learned. So one thing that I would suggest is that before starting a particular, like if, say, even if there is one session, if we can set a goal saying that, okay, I think I would like to learn this. And if I can do this, then it means that I've learned. If a learner is able to say that, then they can only check it, or that can be a crowdsourced way where the lot of onus is not just on the educator, but the students are also able to think about like, how do I know that I've learned this or not? And then they are trying to come up with their own. And I think most of the times, you know, when I work with learners, they are much more creative in coming up with like how they will demonstrate their learning, as opposed to me coming with like one fixed rubric saying that this is how I'm going to measure your thing. Then automatically it puts a condition saying that it has to be an essay or it has to be a project or something like that. So giving that control of assessment also to the learner is something that I encourage you to try, and maybe you can tell us in Trainer Tribe how that went. Joel is saying that it could be a deviation. How would you relate self-learning principles detailed by you with respect to pedagogy and andragogy? So definitely, Joel, I think there is a connection, right? Like self-learning principles. So when you think about the values that we just looked at, those seven values that were listed will manifest in the form of an approach of how you deliver your curriculum, right? Like which is what the pedagogy or andragogy is. So what goes into the design of your session, be it for a couple of hours or be it for a 3-month period or be it a year long engagement, what is the underlying principle that is guiding those lesson plans? And how do we come up with learning objectives? How do we come up with assessment criteria? All of that, it has exact immediate influence on how we will go about that. So that way, the learning self-learning principles and pedagogy are in that sense connected. How can we create a learning climate to students while conducting online sessions? That is like a million-dollar question, Jyotsna, and I think you've really gotten that like very critical aspect. So I think I can suggest, so there is this thing called as online presence. So it also depends on what kind of tools do we use to host these online sessions as well, right? So if it is this webinar kind of a thing, I was keeping my fingers crossed that my video is going to be on and people have good receptivity, that you're able to at least see me and see my emotions that as much as I can show in my body language, and that gives you a connect. So that is one thing. The other thing can be about like just checking in, right? Like, so if we are not doing this is symmetric where you and I are both online, we are in live session. So if it is not that, if it is asymmetric where I am giving you instruction, you're going to come back to me, then having more check-ins of how people are doing. Is this working for you as a technique? What would you like to see as a trigger? So having those kind of conversations and focusing on the relationships aspect is something that comes to my mind, which helps us to create that online presence. And how much are we asking about how they are doing more than, or just as much as what they are learning and how well they are learning is probably one way to do that. Thank you, Ahmed. Thank you, Nirmala. Thanks. Looks like we're going to close the session now. But do share, what aspect that you've learned today, will you be able to apply maybe in the train and drive space?
We can go to the next slide.
Sorry about that.
The next one. Yeah, so I think you guys mentioned, I learned to create a space where learners can come with the confidence even to make mistakes. I think that's great learning.
Oh, that's amazing, Geeta. Like, please do let us know once you've done it, like how that is coming about and what you're experiencing. We would love to hear the stories.
Yeah, so like how Jayashree was mentioning, the conversation doesn't end here. We've just started and it's a huge iceberg, a tip of an iceberg that we are trying to explore. in 60 minutes, 60 odd minutes. So Trainer Tribe, we are on Facebook. So it's an open group. So you can find us on Facebook. And I'm also pinging you the link to join. So please join us on Facebook. It's the online community for educators like you and me. So it's a great platform for us to network with each other, share best practices, learn from each other, inspire each other from stories and experiences from the field, like the one that we just heard right now, right? I mean, allowing our learners to make mistakes and to share and tell us, you know, how their experience has been. So please join us on Facebook. And this conversation and discussions can continue on the Facebook page. So that is a platform for you as educators to explore. We will be again having masterclasses in the coming weeks, and the details of which will be there on our Facebook page. Yashri, can we go to the next slide?
Oh, thanks. Yes.
Yeah. So again, a round of thanks to each one of you for spending your 65 odd minutes with us. Gratitude to Jayashree for handling an engaging session on self-learning. I know it's been challenging to put all your research into like 65 minutes, but I think this is just a start for all of us to go and explore it in detail. Thank you, and thanks to everyone who's promoted this in their network. This is a recorded webinar. We will be uploading the recorded version on our Quest Alliance YouTube page. And it's also live streamed on Facebook. So you can go back to this recording whenever you feel like, and also share the same recording to the others in your network who are unable to participate in this masterclass. You can go to the next slide. Thank you. Thank you once again. Not taking much of your time from a Friday evening, but thank you very much for making your time. And we sincerely, wholeheartedly look forward in having each one of you participate in the future masterclasses. Thank you, Jayashree. Thank you.
Thank you.
We will be closing this meeting in approximately 1 minute from now. Thank you. I'm ending the meeting as of now. Thank you, and have a great weekend ahead. Thank you.
I need your one hand.